Hey, this is One Take Frank, and today I'm going to show you how to make a ricotta meatball. And this is a very good recipe, a very easy recipe, and this is really going to impress your friends. I've got like 4 requests from my friends when they saw my YouTube site. They're like, Frank, when are you going to make your ricotta meatballs? Well, today's the day, so get ready. So we got a lot to do, so we're going to get started. What I'm going to do first, I have my ingredients laid out for the actual ricotta meatballs right here, but before we do that, I'm going to show you how to make a regular tomato sauce. This is the base tomato sauce that I use for just about everything. Except the only difference is this sauce is gonna be loose sauce, so I do add water to this sauce, and I'll show you why at the end. So we're gonna come over here. Right now I have my oil coated in the bottom of my saucepan. Now this is gonna be more of a stock pot than a saucepan. And what I'm gonna use is just one small onion. I just chopped it up already. I put it in the pan, so I stir that up. Now, I didn't mention this. I want to mention this right now while this is cooking. A must that I think everyone needs to have in a kitchen is one of these. If you don't know what this is called a food mill, and they come in a lot of different shapes, a lot of different sizes. And what this does is, and to me, it's important when you make a tomato sauce, because I always use crushed tomatoes, but I don't like the skin, and I don't like the seeds in my sauce. So what this does is, you just pour your crushed tomatoes in the food mill, and when you rotate the handle here, it actually presses the pulp and the sauce through the bottom of this grate, and it leaves the tomato skin and the seeds behind. And that's kind of like what I like. So you get all that full flavor without the seeds and the skin in the sauce. Now, if you like that, then you can just pour the cans right in there. I particularly don't, so I use one of these food mills. I think it's a great device. Now, they come in a lot of different ways. This is one of the new ones. We have about 4 different ones in my house. But this one has probably been in my family for about 40 years. This was my mother's, and then she gave it to us, so we've had it for at least 25. And as you can see, it's kind of worn out. It's got one of these things that hold on, the pod's broken, the top is broken, but I gotta tell you, this is by far the best one, only because inside here, how the food mill is made, you got your grate on the bottom, right? And it's got a little rough edge here that kind of grates your tomatoes a little bit. But the thing that makes this one really good is, this spring on this particular one, and I can't find another one anywhere, has a lot of torque. So it's able to really press the tomatoes through as opposed to the one I just showed you there. So I wasn't going to use this, but you know what? I think I'm going to use it because I like this one. So we're going to use that. So I got my onions here in the saucepan, or I should say in the stock pot. They're all going. And I'm going to use 2 28-ounce cans of crushed tomatoes, okay, for this recipe. So I'm going to take my, I always like a little spice in my sauce, so you don't have to do this if you want. I'm going to just put a little crushed red pepper in there, and I just kind of spin that around. So again, that's totally up to you, if you want to do that or not. I don't really let the onions here caramelize too much, because these ricotta bowls are not going to be fried. They're actually going to be cooking in the sauce for about 35 minutes. And the onions are going to actually kind of almost dissolve in there anyhow, so that doesn't really matter. So I'm going to leave it like that. For now, I'm going to give another quick stir. Then I'm going to use my my broken food mill, okay? And then you just take your can of tomato sauce, crushed tomatoes. Again, any brand, I use all brands, doesn't really matter. And you just kind of spin through on your food mill. You can see how the sauce comes out the bottom. And it's going to leave all the skin and seeds behind. And once I'm done with both of these cans, I'm going to show you what's left behind. So that's one can. There's 2 cans. Now, if you were going to make just tomato sauce for your pasta, and you want to add meatballs or whatever into it, this is all you would do. I would just use the sauce, the olive oil, and the onions there. You could, sometimes I put like 2 or 3 cloves of garlic in there as well. But if that's what you can do for just sauce, this is it. And you just let it cook, simmer for like about maybe 35, 40 minutes to an hour. And that's just your plain marinara sauce will be ready. But for this particular recipe, we're going to do this a little bit differently. Now I'm going to show you what's going to be different about this sauce. You want a loose sauce for these ricotta balls because you're going to cook them in the pot. And this recipe requires a lot of breadcrumbs. And those breadcrumbs are going to absorb a lot of that water. They're going to swell up and they're also going to thicken the sauce. And you'll see that at the very end. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take these cans and I'm going to just put in some water in one of the can, some water in the other can. I'm going to probably use about one full can and a half of water. First, I'm going to see how that goes, but we'll see in just one second. So I just kind of swirl the, only to get the rest of the sauce out of the can. So, just want to get all that out. Now, I wash these cans ahead of time, just so you know, the outside, for this very reason. All right, so I'm going to even take this, because there is residual sauce in here, and I'm going to pour this sauce through the food mill again. This water, I should say, this watery sauce. So this is going to become a very loose sauce when it's all said and done. All right, just want to make sure that goes pretty good there like that. There we go. These food mills are great. They're used for other things too. If you want to make, you know, baby food, or if some, we used to make a vegetable soup where we put a ton of vegetables, all different kinds of vegetables, lima beans, peas, carrots, celery, I don't know, spinach, vegetables that you wouldn't normally eat or I wouldn't normally eat. I just put them in a pot and you kind of overcook them. And then once they're like overcooked, you get all the nutrients still in the pot, they're in the water. Then we just take it and just put it through the food mill, and that would strain all the bulk would come out of it. So anyway, that's about one can of sauce in there. And I think I'm only going to put maybe about another, another quarter of a can of water in here. That'll be it. That'll be good. And that'll be good with that. I'm going to just run this through the food mill. And now, while this sauce is coming to a boil, because that's what you want to drop your ricotta balls in, once that comes to a boil, you're going to want to, and you know, there's pulp on the bottom of this thing. Not so much because I put the water through it, but sometimes you get a little bit of pulp when you don't put the water through. You want to get all that pulp out because that's actually the flavor of the sauce right there. And just to give you a quick idea, if you want to look in here real quick, this is the stuff that comes out, right? So this will be all your, the stuff that wouldn't be in the sauce, the seasoned skin that I kind of take out before it's in there. And that sauce is like a very full-flavored sauce because it is the pulp of the sauce that you got in there. So anyway, I'm going to leave this in here. I'm going to cover it. Now, you salt it to taste. You know, people were asking me when they see me salt things, like, Frank, why don't you use a container of salt? Why are you just using a salt shaker? Well, because this salt shaker actually has this little pour spout on the end of it. So that's what I'm really doing. People thought I was just sprinkling salt in, but I'm actually pouring it in. I don't like to use too much salt, so I'm just going to salt that a little bit to my taste, but you always salt it to whatever you taste you want. All right, so that sauce is going to be in there. And you know, I'm going to tell you something. I think that's a little not too much in there. So you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to just put in maybe another one, a cup of water in there. I'm just thinking these a little bit more. Because when you drop these ricotta balls in here, this is all going to be displaced. It's going to kind of raise up because it's going to do a little sauce displacement, so to speak. All right, so that's it. Well, that's going to cook and come to a boil. We're going to work on our ricotta balls. So the first thing we want to do is, these are going to be ingredients. We're going to use 2 pounds of ricotta, 4 eggs, 13 ounces of breadcrumbs, about 1 pound of chopped meat, and about maybe 2 tablespoons of parsley. Dry parsley is what I use. And then you're going to salt to taste. Sometimes, you know, this will also work with ground turkey, ground chicken, ground pork, whatever you want to use. Sometimes I use a little bit of garlic salt in here to give it a little extra flavor. That's totally up to you. So I'm going to start off by putting in my 13 ounces of plain breadcrumbs. Start with that. I'm going to put in, let me grab my thing here. I'm going to put in my pound of chopped meat right in here. Got that in. Then I'm going to add my 2 pounds of ricotta in there just like that. Normally, you know, if I wasn't one take Frank, I just pour the stuff out of the container right in here. Let's try to look like we're chefs a little bit here. Okay, like that. I'm going to put in my 4 eggs. Make sure we get all that in there. That's good. And my 2 tablespoons of parsley, dry parsley. Now, this is a recipe I usually tell a lot of my friends to make, and I have it by memory. And a lot of them do it, and they always say, Frank, I don't know, they fell apart or this or that. They're always forgetting to put something in, because I'm just telling from memory, not really writing it down. I'm going to just sprinkle some extra salt, maybe a tablespoon of salt in here would be okay. I just don't like to oversalt things. So I try and really watch the salt intake. So I just put a little salt in there. And that's it. I'm going to put it right here into my mixer. Lock that in place. And I don't know what this is called, but this is the mixer I use. So I'm going to just stick that on here while that's in. There, lock it in place. Okay, good. Good to go. Now I'm going to just mix this till it's thoroughly mixed. Probably going to take maybe a minute, 2 minutes. On low. Just mix it on low. You're going to see all the ingredients. And I usually say use 10 to 13 ounces of breadcrumbs. And I usually start with 10. I kind of pour in a little bit more as I go. Excuse me. But the last couple times I've noticed that using 13 was actually working out pretty good. You can use any brand ricotta you want to. I've tried them all. They all work perfectly fine. If you live near a dairy farm and you get fresh ricotta, that makes a difference. That would be so much better. So you let this keep going for a little bit. You'll see it all kind of come together. And what I tend to do is I just give a little bit of a feel, just to see how it feels. You want it to just feel kind of like dry to the touch almost, so it's not sticking to your finger, which it's not. You let it go a little bit more. And while that's going, I want to just check my sauce real quick. It's just starting to come to a boil, which is great. It's looking good. This is looking good. Gee, I wish I had some kind of story to tell you right now. We got some time. Just check and see how this is going. Actually, that feels very good. Feels good. Okay, good. Think we're good to go. So I just want to wash my hands first before I touch this stuff. All right. What I'm going to do next is we're going to make these ricotta balls and we're going to just drop them in the pot. So I want to just clean this mixing element off, get everything off of there, which is good. Use all that. It's fine. Okay. Now we're going to come over here to our pot. I'm going to put this right next to our pot. And I'm going to just wait a minute because I want that to be boiling. It'll be boiling in probably about 30 seconds or so. But I just want that to boil. So in the meantime, what you can do is, usually I start doing my cleanup in the sink while I'm waiting for that to happen. Putting things back. You know what I could do? I could get out a pot because I'm going to make that sauce in there is actually good for about 2 pounds of pasta. Or you actually, if you make like a ziti or something, you can even get away with 3 pounds of pasta. So I typically do it for two because there's not really anybody home right now. I'm going to only make 1 pound. So I'm going to get my water ready for the pasta while we're waiting. I'm going to just take a look at our. It's still going. You know, I gave this recipe one time to a friend of mine, and she knows it, so I'm not really making anything up. She was like a pretty bad cook. I mean, she really can't cook. So I said, listen, why don't you try this ricotta bowl recipe? It's really easy to do, and you're going to look at here with your family. So I give her the recipe, and of all the people I gave this recipe to, she's the only one that actually made it, got success with it, you know, by not watching me do it. And she's like a rock star at her home now. I mean, she makes them, she makes a huge pot, she freezes like half of them, her kids are like, Mom, what are you going to make those ricotta balls again? So, again, really easy thing to do. If you like meatballs, you'll love these ricotta balls. Or, actually, they're ricotta meatballs. All right, so my sauce is now coming to a boil. I'm going to give it a quick stir. Again. Now you want to keep the heat on high when you're dropping these ricotta balls in, because again, you got these cold ricotta balls going the hot sauce is going to kind of lose the temperature there a little bit, so it'll stop boiling as you put them in. All right, I'm gonna just get my hands one more quick rinse, and then I'm gonna start dropping those in. Okay, here we go. So you're going to take these rucka poles, you're going to cup them in your hand like you would a meatball. And I typically make them a little bit bigger than the size of a golf ball, like about that big. And you're going to see, by the time these are done, they're going to swell up. So by the time you drop your last rigotto ball in, that's the time you set your timer for about 35 minutes. That's how long it's going to take for these to cook. And while they're cooking, about 15 minutes into it, again, it's up to you. You have to know your stove. You have to know how you're doing it. As you're going into it, that's the time I put my water on for the pasta, and then I cook my pasta. Now, people always ask, you know, how do you cook your pasta? Now, growing up, I'm Italian. You know, we boiled water, we dropped the pasta in the water. Every once in a while, you knew about how long you go in there. You taste one until you found it was ready. So, you know, I was married, and my wife's making pasta, and she's actually reading the box. And I'm like, Tara, what are you doing? And she's like, I'm just seeing how long to cook the pasta for. I'm like, what do you mean? You read the directions of how to cook the pasta? Turns out that that's the best way to make the pasta. You follow the directions of the box. It even tells you, you know, al dente, tender, you know, however you want it. And they're pretty much, give or take a minute, they're pretty much right on the money. So I always follow the directions on the box, because every pasta brand is different about how long they want to cook it. So, again, see what I'm doing? Just making a pasta. And this is how you know the pasta's good. You know these ricottas are going to come out good, because look at my hands. There's nothing on my hands. If you get a lot of stuff sticking to your hands, you know that you need more breadcrumbs in the mixture. So this is exactly what you want. So I'm going to drop the rest of these in here. And then once I'm done, we're going to come back and I'm going to show you what to do. Okay. So, perfect timing. I got the last one I'm going to drop in the pot right now. The last rigotto ball. Rigotto meatball. Okay, now come on over here real quick. I want you to see the pot real quick, how everything is in the pot. You see how everything is layered in the pot right now? Whenever you're dropping these in, you want to try and put them in a spot where there's nothing kind of holding, you know, where there's spaces in, so the sauce will displace and come up over the top. Now, here's a really key point you need to do here with these rigotto meatballs. I'm going to wash my hands one more time real quick. Right before you start your timer, you get the last one, that's when you set your timer for 35 minutes. What you want to do is, you put your lid on the pot, okay, and you pick up your pot, and you want to just give it a good stir, okay? And what this is going to do, it's going to settle all the rigotto balls together. Take a look in the pot now. See how they're all, like, covered, and they got sauce on them now? That's what you want to have happen, okay? So you want to do that every 7 minutes while it's cooking. You want to come by, pick up the pot, and give it a shake. It'll not let anything stick to the bottom of the pot, like none of the rigotto meatballs will stick to the bottom of the pan or the pot. And it'll also keep settling them down and kind of move them around a bit so they get covered with sauce and they'll cook. They're also going to be steaming here a little bit too. So once this comes to another boil, you're going to lower this down about, just run to medium, just so it starts simmering. You want it to simmer for like 35 minutes, okay? So this has been kind of going. It's actually starting to simmer right now. So I'm going to go ahead and set my timer now. Okay, there we go, 35. I'm going to lower my temperature, and we're going to come back in 35 minutes. Now, what I want to say too is, again, remember, about 15 minutes in, I'm going to turn my water on to cook my pasta. Actually, I'm going to salt my pot too. Salt my water, I'm going to boil my water and make my pasta at the same time. So when these are ready, they're ready together, and you'll have your meal. Okay, so we'll be back shortly. Okay, we're back now. 35 minutes have elapsed on our rigotto bowl, so why don't you come on in, let's take a look what we got. Hopefully they look good. Oh, they look great. Look at that. What a thing of beauty right there. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to try one, make sure they're good. And I want to just show you something about these rigotto bowls. See how much they swell up a little bit? So that's what's going to happen. So I'm going to just cut mine out. They're going to look just like that. Actually, it's perfect texture in the middle. Oh man, these are going to be great. You know what I'm going to do, actually? Since I'm going to eat them, I'm going to actually put a little Parmesan on top of here. This is just a taste, folks, but a little Parm, little crushed red pepper. Hold on a second, Jonathan. What are you doing? My cameraman's so eager to get in there. And I'm going to put a little tomato sauce on top. And actually, I want you to see, too. See, the sauce did actually thicken a little bit with the breadcrumbs from the that were in the ricotta balls themselves, the ricotta meatballs. And my pasta's just about done, actually. Probably is done. All right, let's just give this a taste and see how it is. Oh, man, they're hot. Man, that has got to be the best batch I've ever made. And I'm not even kidding. These are great. These are truly right out of the fountain of youth. Oh, man. They're delicious. Yeah, so good. Okay, so let me just taste my pasta real quick. I did follow the instructions on the box. It should be done. Perfect. So we're going to strain this. You don't have to come to the sink, John. You can just stay right back here while I just strain that real quick. Then what I do is, I'm going to just serve it up in this bowl right here because I don't throw me a pound of pasta, it's not that much. It's just us eating tonight. And I'm going to bring these ricotta balls over friends later on. So I just put a little bit of sauce. This is typically how I always prepare every pasta. I put a little sauce at the bottom of my bowl. Then once I strain my pasta, I'm just going to put it in the bowl. And this was actually a perfect bowl for it. Put a little more on top. I'm going to stir it in from the bottom. Mix it pretty well. Now, this sauce is loose, but I'm going to show you what I'm going to do to make it a little bit better in just a second. I'm going to leave that pasta just like that for right now. And I'm just going to grab a fork. And I'm going to plate a few of these ricotta balls in my plate for the table. Yeah, these are actually came out very good, I got to tell you. These are very firm, yet soft. I mean, this is really a good batch. And this is the way they should be all the time. And, you know, you could kind of, I kind of could tell that just by the way the mix was in the mixer and the way when I was rolling them out, how good they were going to be. So let me just serve them right up like this. Put a few more on here. I hope these kids are hungry tonight because we do have a lot in here. This makes a lot. And you can always refrigerate them. They can stay in the refrigerator for a few days too. I don't like to keep things in the refrigerator more than about 3 or 4 days. Oh, look at that, man. Nice little pile. I'm going to leave that right here on the side for right now. And what I'm going to do now is if you take the sauce from the bottom of the pan, it seems to be a lot thicker. Take a look. See how much thicker it is on the bottom than on the top? You can see that. And that's typically what I do is I take all the ricotta balls out of the pot, then I put the sauce on the pasta because I use the thicker sauce. See how thick it is there in the bottom? It just kind of thickens up. And that's kind of how I let it look. That's perfect, just like that. Okay. That's great. Now, what I'll do is my plate a little bit for the studio audience at home, which there really is no studio audience here. I'm going to just put a little bit in the bowl right here, some pasta. What do you think, John? Is that enough pasta for you, cameraman Jonathan? He's not speaking. I'm going to leave it just like that. Put a couple ricotta balls on there just like that. I'm going to come right back here to my pot. Oh no, where did I put my serving spoon? Here we go. Get a little more of that thick sauce on the bottom. Put that right on top. And a little Parmesan. Just like that. There you go. Looks perfect. I do like a little crushed red pepper on top. How about you, John? You like crushed red pepper? Cameraman's nodding yes. So you know what? I'm going to give it to him. And there you go. There you go. Ricotta meatballs Francesco's Rigotta Meatballs are actually very good. I think you're going to like them. Actually, I think you're going to love them. If they come out this good, you're going to really love them. And that's it. Little Gemelli pasta. And you're good to go. All right, this is One Take Frank. I'm glad you were here. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you liked it, please subscribe to our site. That'd be great. And until I see you next time, have a great rest of your day. Thanks for tuning in. Bye-bye.